So, good afternoon, everybody. Thanks for being here, this first talk in this afternoon session. Our lab is interested in studying the cellular mechanisms underlying neuroplasticity and memory. And the reason is because we think that these mechanisms underlying and neuronal plasticity are indeed linked to the synapse and loss and dysfunction that occurs in dementia disorders and especially in Alzheimer's disease. As you know, brain plasticity and neuroplasticity really decrease over time during aging, and this is especially clear in Alzheimer's disease. Here you have the different changes in memory loss and also in brain activity in the brain with some pathological markers in aging in the in these discontinuous lines. But in the in Alzheimer's disease, the strong lines indicates that these pathological changes, for instance, beta amyloid accumulation in the brain of Alzheimer's disease patients, is somehow related to decrease in memory performance, also in a decrease in activity of different brain regions involved in memory, including the hippocampus, for instance, and also together with this decrease in neuronal activity, there is a decrease in genes that are playing a role in synapse function and structure, as you see here in the red line. One of the regions that are have been more studied in as mediating encoding and storage of some types of memory is the human hippocampus, drawn here by Cajal. And here, in the Schaffer collateral pathways, this is the projection for CA3 hippocampal neurons to CA1 neurons, are very well known, that has plasticity changes, specifically synapse plasticity changes, and these plastic changes at synapses basically are dependent on activity. So activity, neural activity, or synapse activity, indeed, can increase not only the number and the shape of these synapses, but also these synaptic contacts. So this is the main principle of synapse plasticity. And these structural and functional changes at synapses depends on gene transcription, especially at long term. Long term, there is a local events at synapses that are short events that really can change the presence, for instance, of receptors or glutamate receptors or other receptors of a neurotransmitter. And at long term, these signaling cascades basically goes to somehow to the nucleus to regulate gene expression. One of the main transcriptional factors that has been related to these plastic changes and also in neuronal survival is the CMP response element binding protein. This transcription factor. So this transcription factor mainly regulates genes that are then involved in these plastic changes. So after neuronal or synapse activity stimulation, CREB is activated, as you know, induce gene transcription, and these genes really can potentiate this or stabilize these synapses. We recently reported that indeed, in at least in cultured neurons, CREB-mediated transcription depends of transcriptional activators. So some CREB binding protein, CBP, this was already known, but also in this CREB regulated transcription activator 1 or CRTC1 that will be the focus of my talk. This transcriptional coactivator indeed is present at the cytosol or synapses, and then after neurotransmitter activation or the polarization signals, CRTC1 is dephosphorylated by the phosphatase calcineurin, and dephosphorylation of CRTC1 really induces its translocation to the nucleus to activate a specific genes mediated by CREB. So at least until now, most of the genes that are dependent of CRTC1 also depend on CREB. So this will induce gene expression mediated by CREB. So regulation indeed in certain circumstances, especially neuronal activity or synaptic activity stimulus, CREB transcription requires CRTC1. But as I said, one important concept that we introduced in this recent review is that indeed this co-transcriptional coactivator, in contrast to CREB, that is mainly nuclear, is present here, is present at synapses, together with other factors that I'll call synapse to nuclear factor. Why? Because after synaptic stimulation, signals, some of these factors indeed travels through dendrites, goes to the nucleus to activate, in most of the cases, to activate gene transcription. Some of these factors also regulate CREB-mediated transcription, ¿vale? Regulating genes involved in neuroplasticity processes. As you see, and probably you will recognize some of these factors that are involved in cases or familiar cases of autism, for instance, like SANC, either also in schizophrenia, here CRTC1 that we really studied in the context of Alzheimer's disease, as I will explain next. So, still, the role of this synapse to nucleus signaling is in the context of neuropsychiatric or neurological disorder and also in neurodegenerative disease is still unclear. The idea is that at least some of these factors can indeed regulate not gene expression, regulating synaptic plasticity, and these plastic changes can indeed finally regulate memory processing. So, two key questions in the lab were at the beginning whether if CRTC1 deregulation was really relevant for AD pathogenesis. And the second question is whether this factor that was almost unknown in the terms of neuronal function participates in encoding memory altered in neurodegeneration. So for the first part, mainly, most of the results that I will show are published, while the second part, some of the part of the second results are still unpublished. So first, we wanted to know whether this factor really was altered in during the progression, pathological progression of Alzheimer's disease. So indeed, some of the genes that are regulated by this transcriptional factor that are also, as I said, CREB-dependent genes like ARC, nuclear receptor 4A2, are down-regulated in early pathological stages of Alzheimer's disease, approximately, so pathological stage 3-4. CRTC1 is not changed at the mRNA levels. And one gene that is not dependent of CRTC1, like CR61, but depends of CREB, is unchanged. And at the protein level, this, at this pathological stage, there is a decrease in the expression of CRTC1, as you see here. So, but what is the role of this factor in the memory loss or memory impairment in Alzheimer's disease? Of course, we then went to a study one classical Alzheimer's disease transgenic mouse model. This is the APP Swedish Indiana transgenic mice that were from generated in Leonard Mueke's lab in HUSF. This is the pathological development in terms of beta amyloid pathology in this mouse. Basically, at 2 months of age, there is not accumulation of beta amyloid or apparent accumulation of beta amyloid. This accumulation of beta amyloid starts at 6 months of age, intracellularly in the hippocampus mainly. And then, as you see here, so there is no cortical pathology. At 2 months, 12 months of age and on, there is accumulation of amyloid plaques both in the hippocampus and cortex. At this first memory deficit here tested by the spatial memory deficit tested by the Morris water maze test indicates that already at 6 months, not at 2-3 months, at 6 months there is already some learning, spatial learning memory deficits. And this is clear also in the retention test after this learning task, that the first impairments, memory impairment, spatial memory impairments, is around 6 months of age. So to know whether there is a change in the expression of genes in this situation, in wild-type mice and APP transgenic mice after memory training, we performed microarray analysis in the hippocampus of these groups of mice, wild-type mice, APP transgenic mice in naive conditions, or mice trained in the Morris water maze for 5 days here. We also tested it after 3 days, and the results are very similar, of wild-type and APP, so 4 groups of mice. So here is the comparison, the general global transcriptome analysis of comparing the wild-type and APP transgenic mice in naive conditions and trained conditions. As you see, most of the changes in the genes are caused after memory training. So there is more than 900 genes that are potentially changed after memory training in the APP transgenic mice compared with the versus the control. And most, some gene networks alter in this, that include some of the genes are related with memory or neuronal or synaptic plasticity terms like long-term depression, long-term potentiation, and also metabolism. Specifically, we detected that indeed when we analyze more than 150 genes that are potentially dependent on CREB, these are all the genes that we check in the microarray, there is some, most of these genes are indeed not changed between naive wild-type and APP, naive APP transgenic mice, but already after training, there was a clear differential deregulation, downregulation here and upregulation here of genes in the APP transgenic mice. As you see here, after training in wild-type mice, these genes are upregulated, but there is not upregulation in the APP transgenic mice. So these are genes that depend on CREB. So when we test whether these genes were dependent or not of the coactivator CRTC1 by using by transducing cultured neurons, hippocampal neuron with an shRNA for CRTC1. We saw that most of these genes indeed are dependent somehow, are dependent on CRTC1. So there is a downregulation of these genes after transduction with this shRNA for CRTC1. Some genes are CR1, as I said, is independent of CRTC1 and is not changed in these conditions. So we can say that indeed there is an alter CRTC1 CREB dependent transcription in the hippocampus of APP mice and specifically after memory training. This is just also the levels, at the levels of protein levels also are reduced. And the interesting thing is that when we compare, when we perform bibliography, in the bibliography, the levels of some of the genes, these are classical genes, C4s, neurofilament, NF4A1, NF4A1, 2, synaptotagmin and BDNF, etc. Most of these genes, indeed, has been already published to be downregulated in Alzheimer's disease brain in different pathological stages. So most of the some of these genes that depend on and somehow on CRTC1 were already shown to be downregulated in this pathological condition. What is the mechanisms by which this transcriptome changes specifically for CRTC1 dependent genes in these mice? So one explanation is that the levels of the phosphorylated inactive form of CRTC1 is increased in the APP mice. As you see here, both in naive conditions, but specifically after training where there is a decrease in the phosphorylation and then the activation, no? Of CRTC1 is indeed impaired in the APP transgenic mice. Somehow, for some reason, we think that is because alteration in the dephosphorylation of CRTC1, mediated by calcium of CMP signals, indeed decrease the dephosphorylation and activation of CRTC1 in this in the hippocampus of these APP transgenic mice. But are this downregulation or the regulation of CRTC1 mediating these memory deficits? This is difficult to answer, but as a proof of concept, experiment, we perform transduction with using adeno-associated virus, expressing the wild-type form, just attacked with MYC of CRTC1. Specifically, this virus specifically transduced neurons. We inject it in the hippocampus. As you see, most of the neurons in the CA3 and also in the CA1 neurons are transduced with this lentivirus with CRTC1, here tagged with the MYC, as I said. So this, after 3 weeks, we test the mice in the Morris water maze again. And as you see here, this gene therapy approach can indeed reverse the learning, spatial learning, memory learning deficits, and also can recover the spatial memory deficits in the APP transgenic mice, comparing APP transduced with GFP or with CRTC1, as you see here. Also, in terms of this therapeutic approach, also can recover or can increase the partially, not totally, the deficits in some of the genes that I indicated previously that were dependent on CRTC1. So once shown that somehow the CRTC1 mediated transcription could be relevant in AD pathogenesis, the next question was to know whether CRTC1 participates in other memories affected in neurodegeneration. For that, we use a mouse model that we generated a few years ago. These are the presenilin-1-2 conditional double knockout mice. These mice indeed has a deletion of a conditional deletion mediated by CAM kinase 2 alpha promoter Cre recombinase specifically in excitatory neurons of the forebrain, and these mice were crossed with PS2 knockout mice to generate this double knockout mice. And this is a faithful model of neurodegeneration. It's not exactly Alzheimer's disease, but it's indeed a model of neurodegeneration. As you see here, with a thinning of the cortex, and also reduction in the hemispheres, cortical hemispheres, and also indeed there is a clear severe neuronal loss in these mice, at least at, starting at 6 months of age. And this is very clear, 9 months of age, for instance. You have here a wild type and double knockout mice. This mouse, we knew that already that has deficits in another kind of memory that is associated learning memory. In these mice, indeed, also is similar, the result is similar. So, in this presently conditional knockout mice, there is a decrease in the dephosphorylation and activation of CRTC1. There is a decrease in the nuclear translocation of CRTC1 from dendrites and cytosol to the nucleus, as you see here. And when we perform the gene therapy approach using this adeno-associated virus, we see a partial recovery of the contextual associated memory at 24 hours in this contextual memory test. Also, there is a partial recovery of some of the morphological changes at synapses after CRTC1 overexpression. Finally, my last slide, it's how really this factor can regulate synaptic plasticity and associated memory that is dependent of the hippocampus. So we use the contextual fear condition, contextual fear memory test. So here you have, very quickly, you have mice that were injected in the hippocampus with a controlled shRNA on the left, and with an shRNA for CRTC1. As you see here, that this mouse remember the shock, the previous shock, done 24 hours, while this mouse was indeed behaves almost like didn't remember really the shock. So here is a quantification after CRTC1 silencing. There is a decrease in this freezing response. And CRTC1 overexpression indeed increased the levels of freezing, suggesting that CRTC1 indeed is regulating this memory task, this memory. And this is probably mediated by regulation of LTP. CRTC1 overexpression increased LTP, and shRNA inactivation of CRTC1 decreased maintenance of LTP. And this is just briefly very quick, this is mediated probably by regulation of NMDA-dependent neurotransmission, as you see here. There is an increase in the NMDA currents amplitude in the mice that are overexpressing CRTC1 and a decrease after inactivation of CRTC1. There is a change. There is a change in the number and also in the morphology of the synapses. And then not only this, we see that CRTC1 can regulate the expression of total expression of CRTC1, but also is required for the synaptic localization of the one of the subtypes of the of this NMDA receptor, that is subtype 1, GLUEN1, to synapses. Finally, if you want more information, we have some data in the poster number 32. This is just to summarize. So although we don't completely demonstrate that really CRTC1 is playing a specific role as synapses, it seems that besides that regulates synaptic plasticity, structural and functional synaptic plasticity, by regulating not only gene expression at the nucleus, but probably has local effects at synapses, mediating this translocation of GLUEN1 receptors to the PSD, mediated by PKC. These are data that we have in the poster. And just finally, I would like to acknowledge the people in the lab that has contributed to this work, Arnaldo Parras, Lilian Enriquez, Ana Dalcer, our collaborators in the CyberNet group, Dr. Rodriguez Lab, also our collaborators within the CyberNet network, lab of Silvia Ginés, and also Antonio Rodriguez Moreno at the UPO that performed the electrophysiological recordings. Thank you.
Thank you, Carlos, for staying on time. And we have time maybe for one single question. There are no questions. I have a curiosity. You showed in the initial slides that CRTC1 is in the synapse. Mm-hmm. And how does it get to the nucleus? Is it well known how it gets transported to the nucleus? Yep.
For most of these synaptic proteins, the importing mediated pathway is involved in this synapse to nucleus signaling. So this takes, in some cases, minutes or almost less than an hour. So yeah, and this is the general mechanisms for most of these synaptonuclear factors.
Yeah. And you showed it a phosphorylated form. Does it depend on phosphorylation to get more efficiently to the nucleus? Or
we see a correlation between the phosphorylation. The phosphorylation occurs in vivo. I didn't show it, but in vivo, after, for instance, the memory training in the context of air conditioning test, it takes in minutes. And this translocation, it takes in about 10 minutes already we can see the nuclear localization of CRTC1. The images that I show, it was for 15 minutes. Okay. So it seems that there is a correlation between first the phosphorylation and then the nuclear translocation. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.